And good morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Soft Spot. Great day to be alive. Another day above ground, another opportunity to help someone. And we're talking about helping today. Last week we were talking about the heartbreak syndrome. A lot of times we would hear it as a cliche that people have a broken heart. And we would kind of overlook it. We would just bypass it like it was just something to say. You know, it's something that sounded real hip, real cool, real fly to say, even though it in fact is real. And we know today that it's a syndrome. It's identified as being a syndrome, but we also know that it is trauma. I was going over some of the symptoms last week as to what it looks like. So I'm going to follow back up with that this week, today, and see if we can't do some healing after we cover some of the information from last week. So I was on the HopkinsMedicine.org site. For those of you who don't know, Johns Hopkins, one of the most well-renowned in research, does a lot of patient care. And on this site here, it talked about, we identified last week, stress cardiomyopathy is what is referred to as the broken heart syndrome. And we talked about some of the symptoms, and we talked about last week the symptoms being symptoms similar to a heart attack. Chest pain, shortness of breath, congestive heart failure, and low blood pressure. Listen, this is some serious stuff here. And we would constantly tell people, get over it, move on, you know, get another man, woman, whatever your flavor is. You know, that's what we would tell people, just move on. There's another one out there for you. Not realizing that when you truly love somebody, right, that it's heartfelt love. We're not talking about that intellectual idea kind of love. You know, when you talk about being heartbroken and you talk about stress cardiomyopathy, you're talking about some heartfelt, down-to-the-bone love, right? Love. You're talking about like a genuine concern for that other person. And no, that's not always the case in every relationship, because relationships are established on many different things. But when you establish a relationship on love, I mean true love, I mean in alignment with God kind of love, right? That hurts when something takes place in the relationship, and it's not always infidelity. It's not always something that's relationship destroyable, where, you know, it's irreparable damage. It doesn't mean that it doesn't hurt. Sometimes just disappointment about certain things can cause a person to be brokenhearted. It's a level of stress that is put upon the heart, right? And what you have to understand is that when things are said and people say, like, what comes from the heart reaches the heart, when people say things to you, right, whether it be out of anger, whether it be out of frustration, whether it be impulsively, but when it's something said and it reaches your heart, right, it's a long road back sometimes from that, because you have an expectation of people. Whether it's realistic or unrealistic, it's an expectation that you have that a person is going to respond or not respond to you in a particular manner. And when you get those unwelcomed or unwarranted perceived or actual responses, and you internalize them first through your mind, because in your mind you have conceptualized this person. You see this person in a certain light, and you hold them to a certain level of esteem, where they reside within you. And we're talking about love here. We're not talking about some idea-focused, single-minded relationship concept. We're talking about some sincere devotion, commitment, loyalty-driven stuff here, right? So we put people in certain places within us. And when they fall off of that elevated status that we put them on, it's devastating to us. So it's not necessarily anything that they did that causes this. Sometimes it's just something about you and where you put that person and the expectations that you put upon that person that causes this. But no matter which way it's caused, no matter what the reason, rationale, any of those things that you formulate within yourself, when it reaches the heart, that's where we have a serious problem. Because once it reaches the heart, it becomes a medical condition. It is no longer a cognitive change solely. Now it's a matter of this could turn into something really serious. I just told you some of the symptoms are it almost feels like you're having a heart attack. And in some cases, people have been known to have heart attacks as a result of that broken heart. You know how, we see people who are together for long periods of time, be it in whatever capacity, marriage or just living together, but they're together for a long period of time, and when the other person passes on to the next life, that other person yearns to be there too. And not long after that other person passes, along with that other person, because they want to be with that person, because they are so heartbroken, they are so distraught within themselves that they can't pull it together no matter what. And some people will label that as being some level of a sick kind of love. I said, how can you let yourself get to the point of loving and caring for somebody to the degree that you lose yourself? Well, part of relationship development is finding the complement to self. And I'm going to always go back to the creation of man. And when I'm speaking about the creation of man, I'm looking at man and woman, because Adam was by himself for a period of time. I don't know how long of a period of time that he was on in his place. We'll put it like that. In his place. The place that he was in. Right? Don't know how long he was there. Alone. But God in his infinite wisdom knew that Adam needed companionship, right? He knew he needed companionship. But obviously it was companionship that was not like Adam. Let me be clear on that. Obviously God in his infinite wisdom knew that the companionship that Adam needed was not to be like him. Therefore, he blessed him with Eve. Let's understand that. He blessed him with Eve for a reason. Now, I can't begin to conceptualize God's infinite wisdom in any capacity. I can look around and I can see the splendor of the life that we live today as human beings, and that which we see in nature every day. But I can tell you that my experience has been that there's a certain complement. There's a certain asset that comes along with me being in a relationship with a woman. There are things that come forth from within that only a woman can bring forward. Therefore, when we start looking at heartbreak, and we start looking at trauma, and we start looking at how necessary relationships are, right? Then we have to begin to look at how it's possible to be heartbroken, right? Now, I'm not going to go into this today, but it's the same when we look at parental separation, when we look at a child not being able to have regularity in their contact with both parents. There's a necessity for that. But that's going to be on another show. But so is such that you see people who are together for periods of time, and somewhere along the line, they begin to almost mimic one another. They begin to have, and it's like, it's funny because their features begin to look almost similar in some capacities. Their behaviors begin to look similar in many capacities. They begin to talk the same. For instance, if I'm with a woman who is from down south and here we are up north and we're together, it's just a matter of time before the diction in my speaking begins to change. Right? There's some things that she may say as far as some cliches or something like that that I may carry on with. There are a lot of things when you're in love with the person, not when you're with the person, but when you're in love with the person, you begin to take on some of their characteristics. Oh, the good characteristics and the bad. Don't get it twisted, because you can absorb somebody's flaws as well. And depending on the healthiness or lack thereof of the relationship will really determine what it is that you're going to absorb. Right? It's like a smoker being with a non-smoker. Now, you're getting secondhand smoke and you may never smoke. But if you are a former smoker, a person who once smoked, and you're with a person who smokes, you are constantly exposed to the trigger. And depending on how that person utilizes that substance will really determine whether you absorb it in the same capacity. So for instance, people smoke, they have their habits that go along, their behaviors that go along with cigarette smoking. For me, and early on, when I first got clean, I wanted to stop smoking cigarettes. But in order for me to do that successfully, I had to stop drinking coffee for a while. I'm drinking it now, though. Because it was the trigger. As soon as I picked up a cup of coffee and started drinking the coffee, I wanted the cigarette to go along with it. It was like it was an accompaniment. It was like another condiment, right? It was another flavor enhancer. See, because I had the sugar, I had the cream, I had the coffee itself, and there was a certain, blend. I need to have the dark roast. I like Colombian blend. I like the real dark stuff, right? And then I had the cigarette, which they kind of worked together on the palate. It didn't, you know, separate. It had them together, so I had to change that. So, then that's a very negative. Now, if you look at even ice cream, right, sweets, let's use sweets, for example, because sweets was another big thing for me. I would inhale a dozen of donuts and an extra large coffee. When I say extra large coffee, I'm talking about the extra large coffee that had extra sugar and cream. And any of those of you who have gone and gotten coffee, you know when you say extra, that means extra sugar and extra cream. So I was an extra, extra kind of person, but I would have like two or three of them in the course of a day, right? Because that's my makeup, that's my chemical balance. I'm naturally high strung, right? So those things in me put me at another level. And, you know, I had to learn over time to decrease those things. But where I was going with this was that, you know, my wife too likes sweets. Now, we've cut back substantially. I mean, really, we both have. And by the time her and I connected, I had really, you know, come down even more. But there are times, you know, of late where I don't keep a whole lot of sweets in the house. And she'll go get some things because, you know, I like those things, and because she wants to give me those things because, you know, I like them. And even though I say, well, babe, I'm good, you know, I have to have more of a will to not eat them when they're in here as much. But, you know, I'm saying all to say that I'm decreasing. She makes sure I have because she knows I enjoy them. But when you have a person who is, you know, trying to decrease their intake and decrease their presence of those things, and then you have the other person who brings those things in just in case you want them. And I mean, and I get it. And so it's what I'm saying is that you have to look at all of these things. And when you start looking at a trauma in regards to a broken heart, you have to look at the absence of the person in just those two areas. One was a totally negative and one was a very positive. But you still look at those things, and there are a lot of things that take place in the course of a relationship that we get acclimated to on a regular basis in our lives. Waking up and seeing that person in the morning, right? Going to bed with that person at night. I mean, that's your comfort. You get in bed, you snuggle. Right? Sitting down watching a movie, laughing and joking about a movie, talking, having dialogue about, you know, a television program you may be watching, having dialogue about religion, you know, just talking about God. Walking in the park, sitting down in a chair watching a movie and somebody in the kitchen fixing a meal and bringing you, you know, something to drink and all those things that we often take for granted. Those things we often take for granted, right? And when I say take for granted, some of us don't even look at it with a level of gratitude and appreciation that we have those things. When my wife gives me a glass of water, I say thank you. When she gets something for me from another part of the house, I say thank you, right? Because some people are in relationships where none of those things even take place. When nobody's bringing them a glass of water, when nobody's saying good morning, when nobody's putting a blanket over them because they've fallen asleep in the chair. All kind of things that some just like take for granted, and like it don't mean nothing. It's like it's an expectation that you're supposed to do that. So why should I thank you for it? But that's not how I'm cut. That's not the cloth that I'm cut from. You know, and I've learned over the years that I used to be cut from that kind of cloth, and I cut that cloth away from me. I cut that cloth away from me, but things take place in the course of your day, and without even thinking about it, right? Just going through the course of your day, all these things that take place with that other person. The expectations that we develop of that other person. Knowing that they're going to always be there, even though we know that's not in the literal sense that they're going to be there, but we're in a relationship together, so, you know, we've made that commitment, so that means that we, in a sense, expect that person to be there. Always. We know that death is inevitable. We know that things happen and people part ways, but it's just not an expectation that you and I are going to part ways. Especially if I'm not doing anything or you're not doing anything to cause it to happen. So when you go through all of that and you go through the regimen of your day, and then that changes in any capacity. But for the moment, I'm going to talk about separation. And when I mean separation, I don't mean that we're just going to be away from each other for a period of time. I mean that the relationship is over. because there's another level of heartache when you're separated, right? But I'm talking about the trauma of the loss of the relationship, where some people never bounce back from it. You follow what I'm saying? Some people never bounce back from it. They carry it through the duration of their lives. But the residue of it, the residue of that heartbreak, is what eats them alive. And not only does it eat them alive internally, it begins to eat alive their surroundings, everything around them. It's like, you know, King Midas was known to touch things and they turn to gold. Well, heartbreak trauma doesn't do that. It does totally the opposite. It turns everything to crap. It resides in you, in your spirit, and it just rapes you of pleasure, joy, hopes, dreams, and aspirations. And even though you continue to go to work, you go on autopilot of a sort. Yeah, autopilot exists. You think that you're doing it on your own, but no, sometimes we go into autopilot. I'm just telling you about the human being is so, so magnificent. We go into autopilot in certain situations of trauma and don't even realize that we're in this life, because we're so disconnected from what's happening. We walk through this, and some days we ask ourselves, how did we get through it? We ask ourselves that question. And every time we experience a trigger, right? It resurfaces. And when you're with someone else, it presents itself. And it presents itself in ways that, in many ways, you're unconscious to. When it talks about here, and I'm still on the Johns Hopkins site, hopkinsmedicine.org, it says, is stress cardiomyopathy dangerous? And it says here that it can definitely be life-threatening in some cases. Because the syndrome involves severe heart muscle weakness. Now I want you to listen to this. Because the syndrome involves severe, right? Severe heart muscle weakness. Now, what that means is what? It's like the heart has been decreased in its performance, right? Patients can have congestive heart failure, right? That means it just shuts down. It has slowed in capacity. It's not performing. It is severely damaged, right? It is severely damaged. This is the blood flow. This is what keeps everything moving, right? And it has to beat at a certain capacity. It has to pump at a certain capacity to keep the individual healthy. When it begins to decrease, right? Or when it begins to be forcing, and you feel it through your chest, right? Because it's just not functioning at the level that it needs to be, then that's when that chest pain comes. And that's when all your other bodily functions begin to change, because the blood flow is different. And I'm not going to go into all the medical stuff because I'm not qualified to do that. I can only read some of the stuff from the site and liken some of the things to my clinical experience and my clinical expertise. And knowing that when your heart is not operating at the capacity that it was designed to, that can be devastating, dangerous, and life-threatening. That much I can't tell you. It talks about low blood pressure. Your pressure, the blood pressure, it has to flow at a certain capacity. That's what your heart is doing. It's just bloom, 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 bloom. And each one of those pumps is pushing the blood. And the blood has to keep moving at a certain capacity. Once that blood slows and it goes like bloom, bloom, you start having other effects on the brain as well. You're talking about oxygen and that whole chemical balance of blood. Everything that's within your blood, the red, white blood cells, all those things have to move to keep it moving, to keep mixing, you know, to keep that blend going. It's like having a cup of coffee, letting it sit for about 5 minutes without drinking it, and when you look at it, you got a skin on top. Well, that's what begins to happen with blood of a sort. If it's not flowing at its capacity, right, and keep moving through the veins, you start looking at when you talk about congestion, you start looking at the veins starting to, you know, collapse some. You know, when the regular blood flow keeps the veins open, it keeps the arteries open. But when you have blood that stops flowing the way it's supposed to, then you start looking at it starts coagulating of a sort, right? It starts thickening because it's not doing what it's supposed to do, so it starts slowing down, right? And this is real, folks. I want you to know what's going on with you when you're sitting there hurting and you're feeling like you're going to die. Not what you're telling yourself in your mind in some cases that you just want to die, but you're feeling like, oh my God, this is, you can't get your breath. You feel the tightness in your chest. You feel like you're having a stroke or something. It says it up here, it says it can also occur following numerous physical stresses to the body, right? So it's a whole lot of things that can happen. And if you've had certain conditions that have already happened, like for some who've had strokes, for some who've had some, you know, cardio issues, right? It could be devastating. You could die. You could die. So it says the good news, let me read one last thing on that as well. Because I talked about low blood pressure and I talked about shock. When I was talking about how the human body takes care of itself, and when you go into shock, right, everything else is going on around you, but it's like you have that tunnel vision and you're locked into the loss itself. It's like the disbelief. And the human being goes on autopilot and gets you through until you can get back in alignment, right? You got to get back in alignment, right, with your spirit, which means that you need to reconnect with God. Because if you don't and you stay in that condition, right, it can have dire consequences for your future, because you can find yourself losing a whole lot of things around you, you know, friends, family members, jobs, homes, because if you fall victim to being in that position, then you're not paying attention to the bills coming in, the obligations and things, and you can lose a whole lot. And then when you come through it, you like, wow, I lost all of this because of him? Because of her? No, not because of either one of those things. Because you didn't see that. You didn't see what was happening. And you didn't grab it by the horns and take control of it. You allowed it to get out of control. Right, wrong, or indifferent, it happens. It happens to all of us in some capacities. But it also talks about life-threatening heart rhythm abnormalities. You know, potentially life-threatening heart rhythm abnormalities. Because what happens is, depending how long you're there, right, you can cause the rhythm of your heartbeat to be off. And sometimes it can become irreparable. If you stay there, depending on how long you stay there, and then if you come out of one situation into the next, and another stressful situation, your job is stressful, everything around you begins to really weigh on you. How does sudden stress lead to heart muscle weakness? So let me help you understand that. First, it is important to understand, and I'm reading this from the site, HopkinsMedicine.org. First, it is important to understand what stress is. Stress refers to the body's response to things it perceives as abnormal. These abnormalities can be physical, such as high body temperature, dehydration, or low blood sugar, or can be emotional, such as receiving news that a loved one has passed away. When these abnormalities occur, the body produces various hormones and proteins such as adrenaline and noradrenaline, which are meant to help cope with the stress. Again, the body takes care of itself. For example, if a person is suddenly threatened and fears physical harm, the body produces large amounts of adrenaline to help that person either defend himself or run faster to escape the danger. And that's that fight or flight, right? With stress cardiomyopathy, we believe that the heart muscle is overwhelmed by a massive amount of adrenaline that is suddenly produced in response to the stress. The precise way in which adrenaline affects the heart is unknown. It may cause narrowing of the arteries that supply the heart with blood, causing a temporary decrease in blood flow to the heart. Alternatively, the adrenaline may bind to the heart cells directly, causing large amounts of calcium to enter the cells, which renders them temporarily dysfunctional. Whichever the mechanism, it appears that the effects of adrenaline on the heart in this syndrome are temporary and completely reversible, as will be discussed further. Now, again, I stated earlier that it could be irreparable, depending on what pre-existing conditions you may have had. Because if you've had some previous heart challenges, right? And now this comes along for you and you have a heart attack, right? You can't change that. Yes, you can heal from the circumstance that you have perceived, because it says here, have perceived as being abnormal. There's nothing abnormal about a failed relationship, right? But I talk about the normalcy that is developed when you're with someone, right? There's a normalcy that's developed in my daily interaction with people. That is normal. That's the norm for me. Did I wake up every day to you? Did I go to bed, you know, with you at night? Did I come home, you know, from work and you're there, or you're coming home and you'll be there? It's a whole lot of things that go along with all of that. And we're not even talking about death. The focus here is on a failed relationship and the heartbreak associated with that and the conditions associated, the traumatic conditions associated with the heartbreak. So people can say all they want that they moved on. And I say this, anyone, and it's funny because my wife and I were watching one of those holiday movies on Hallmark, and it was a guy who, well, you know, it's the same story on Hallmark. If you ever watch Hallmark, it's like you can watch Hallmark all day and it's one big damn card. Like everybody looks the same. All the stories are pretty much like one after the next, but anyway, the male who was initially interested in the woman, right, was acting stupid, right, as males can often do, And he was like real harsh in how he talked to her, and he was just like real negative, very arrogant, you know, but he had a little bit of paper, and he thought that that was going to be the basis of his love with her, and that she was going to come with him. Then it was another person, a good guy like myself, you know, very accommodating, loving, caring, you know, of that, you know, like me, who she met. And she began to experience, you know, some joy in that interaction. I didn't say she fell in love with him, but she began to experience some joy in that interaction. Anywho, one day the good dude was having a conversation with her, and the bad dude walked up and overheard the conversation. Right? So what he did was, he in essence, gave her an ultimatum. Listen, we're about to fly out, pack and come or not, but I'll be flying out. So the good guy, he went and stood behind her, and she pretty much told dude, okay, well, in other words, like, have a nice flight, because I'm staying. Not that she was staying with dude, but that, like, she ain't going with him. So no sooner than he left, right, her good guy was standing there talking, and he was praising her for being strong and making that decision, and then they kissed. Right? So it's like, wow. You know, my wife says, so, wow, it's amazing how in one minute you can be with somebody else, love that other person, things not work out, and you turn right around and be with somebody else. And it just happened, right? The breakup just happened. No, what I was telling her was the breakup happened a long time ago. See, in situations like that, they were already broke up. They just haven't physically parted ways. So a lot of times when you find yourself in that situation where you can just immediately part ways with the person, you've been parting ways with them for some time. And that's why it's sometimes easier to move on. There's other situations where it happens spontaneously, instantaneously, where there wasn't a sincere devotion and commitment to that relationship in the beginning. It was based on nothing. Or whatever image that person wanted. It was based on an idea concept of a relationship and not an ideal. And remember, the ideal concept of a relationship is the prescription, the one that is prescribed, the one that in your teachings, in your book, you know, those things prescribed by God, that is an ideal relationship. Those things that we conceptualize in our mind, absent of, void of the ideal, are only idea. Therefore, you know, it's easy to part ways from those things. So, I say all that to say that when you look at when the decision comes for that to happen, it's never anything you can prepare for. It's been the normalcy of my life. You know, saying that I can prepare for my wife to not be there ever again, that's just like saying that my glasses and my optics will change. I won't have to wear glasses again. And if I take my glasses off like now, everything looks like you start putting your hand out trying to feel around. But when you put them back on, there's clarity. And one of the things that happens over time is that we go see the ophthalmologist and get our lenses checked after certain ages at a certain level of frequency to keep that clarity on the lens. When that person is no longer there, it's like not having the glasses on. It's like not having the glasses on. And in order to work through the trauma, to clarify the lens, right? There's some things that need to begin to happen. And we're going to talk about that in the second half of the show. But when you start looking at where you are in your relationship, right? You have to look at how healthy the situation is for you. If you find that heartache often, right, then it's a good chance that it's not a healthy situation to be in. When you find yourself questioning everything about the person, then you'll find that there's a good chance that you're not in a healthy situation, right? But here's the hit here, right? The longer you stay, the more normal that situation becomes. That's that normality, that normalcy that takes place. Because even though it's unhealthy, you grin and bear it and remain. And then what happens with that is, when you know it's no good and don't walk away from it, and you start building those resentments add to the heartache that's coming. Because now it's a matter of, I stayed with you all of this time, through all of this, and you continue to do the same thing, and now you leave? Well, you're really not a victim in this. Because my response to that would be, well, why didn't you leave if that's what you felt? Don't point fingers and blame. We both stayed, but when you turn around and you blame me for your internal condition as a result of an external circumstance that you had full control over, that's a problem. Because for some, high conflict relationships are normal. There's nothing abnormal to them about it. But when you put a low conflict person and a high conflict person together, it's just a matter of time before one changes the other. And I can guarantee you, if you're a low conflict person and you're in a high conflict, in a relationship with a high conflict person, it's just a matter of time before you become high conflict. Just like any other actions of abuse. When somebody is bullied and abused by someone, it's just a matter of time before that person too becomes a bully. And they may not flip the script on that other person, but they may begin to bully others. They may begin to abuse others. That's inevitable. If you know anything about abuse, you'll find that out. Just look it up. When people are abused, it becomes the norm for them to do it to others, because it's been ingrained within them that that is a means that they can rely upon in certain circumstances. So you have to look at that. When you have two people together, it's important to understand how people deal with certain things. How do people deal with distress of finances, of bills coming in? How do they deal with those things? It's almost time to zap the coffee. I know you probably have yours too. You just have the ability to walk around and zap yours at will. I got to take a break so I can zap mine. But we're going to break in a few minutes and I can go ahead and heat that up. So again, when we were talking about the symptoms and we were talking about stress being perceived abnormalities, this is where you have to begin to do some work and look at what you're feeling, how often you're feeling that. Is that what you want to feel from this person? Because, you know, we talk with, I'm feeling you, right? But is that what you want to feel from that person? What do you want to feel from that person? What do you really want? And oftentimes, I can tell you in relationships, we mix apples and oranges so frequently. And what happens is, we find ourselves in situations with great sex, and then we just deal with the rest. Right? We just deal with the rest. Or we find ourselves in situations where strong finances, and we just deal with the rest, no matter whether it's satisfying or anything, or something to do. Right? You have to look at, right, how when we say people settle, we all settle. We all settle. Some of us settle for lesser than others. But lesser for me, could be more to somebody else. You don't know. And it's based on the individual. Oh, that's all you going through? Y'all just argue every day? Hell, this Negro putting his hands on me, beating me down every day. I'll take the arguing every day over this. No. How about take none of it? How about take none of it? So again, it's based on one's conditioning and tolerance and level of intimacy in terms of high conflict or low conflict interaction. If you're a person who you know is always honing in on things about your partner, that's high conflict. That's who you are. You're high conflict. Because if you're with me, leave me alone. Why are you like picking things apart? I'm not talking about things such as, people cleaning up behind themselves and all that. You can see somebody's domestic qualities and stuff like that. And if you have if that's your issue, then you just go ahead and pick the stuff up yourself. But if you're always picking apart things that are said and only honing in on something that you're in disagreement with, what's the point? You don't want happiness. Not the same I'm looking for, because all you want to do is point things out. All you want to do is find things wrong. You need to find things right. And I often talk to clinicians about the same thing. First thing people talk about when somebody comes in for treatment is, tell me what's wrong with you. Why does everything have to be wrong? What's right with you? How's things been going? Oh, well, they've been going all right. I slipped. Okay. What did you slip from? Not what you slipped into. What did you slip from? Well, I was, going to work every day. I was taking care of the family and got a home and, had some things going on for a while. And then she started complaining about I was drinking too much and things just got really, really heavy. Working extra hours, so on and so forth. Okay. So we saw the good things that the person was doing. So they slipped. All right. And we don't need to call it anything other than. So when you say you slipped, how do you think that you need to get your footing back so you can be able to get back on that foundation that you were on? And let them tell you. Right? So, if you're a high conflict person, you're not going to do well with a low conflict person. I'm going to tell you that. I'm not a high conflict person. I avoid conflict like the plague because I don't like being in that space. I don't like being in a space where there's high conflict because it doesn't make me feel real good. It makes me nervous. It makes me nervous being in that space because all kinds of things go on internally and I don't deal that well with it. But I have so much between me getting to that space and me being away from that space. There's too much that I have in between, too many options and skills that I've developed, personal skills and things that I've developed throughout the years, that by the time I get halfway there, I'm going in the opposite direction. I'm not telling you I don't experience any bouts of anger, but before I get to that part, that dude, I'm out. Because I already know what comes along with that. Guilt, shame, embarrassment, remorse, and a whole bunch of other things. Incarceration. Yeah. So I know all those things that come about as a result of me allowing myself to get there. Therefore, being in a high conflict relationship is not going to work for me. And that's the look that people need to begin to have. Because when we start talking about healing, that's going to be an intricate part of it. You have to self-assess. You have to look at you and ask yourself. I did a video a couple years back. I think I actually did maybe one, two. I think it's a three-part series on how did I get here? I would suggest you go to my YouTube station and look for that video, How Did I Get Here, and watch each one of them. So you can see how you got to where you are in that kind of a relationship. Because if we don't start looking at how we got somewhere, especially when it comes to relationships, we're going to keep getting there. And I can tell you, many years of my life, I keep getting back there. I keep getting there to the there I don't want to be. And continue to ask myself, how did I get there? Which is why so many people are lonely today and alone. Because they're not looking to find out how they got there. They're blaming somebody for why they are there instead of trying to get away from there. And you can only find out how to get away from there if you find out how you got there. Period. You have to learn how to find your way back. This is important to understand. So when I'm talking to you, I'm talking to me too. Because there are different places that I have found and that I find myself in, where I ask myself, how did I get here? And I need to learn how I got there so I don't do it again. Whatever it may be. Even if it's something as simple as, how did I get to the point of having an argument about a particular thing? How did I get here? How did I get there? Not how did she get me here, how did I get there? How did I get myself there? Because nobody has the power to get me somewhere. When you're talking about relationships and you're talking about emotions, you know, when you're talking about cognitive distortions, you're talking about you. You're not talking about the other person, because this comes down to perception. Hence the trauma, the stress, the increased stress is based on perceived abnormalities. The must-itises, the can't-stand-itises, the should-itises, the must-itises, those things, right, aid in our abnormal perception of things. No human being is guaranteed to be with you forever. You're not guaranteed to be in existence forever. So why would you think that somebody else should be in existence with you forever? Death is inevitable. I live to die. I plan every day to live, right, in the capacity of the afterlife. So I live today for the next life. Therefore, what I do, I strive to live this life, right, to the best of my ability, being the best servant to God that I can possibly be, in the capacity of a human being who has all this stuff that he's acquired for 56 years of life. But if I stay that course, it's guaranteed that I'll be in paradise. So I live from that perspective of life. I don't fear death in any capacity. I'm not telling you I'm foolish that if somebody aims I've had guns and shotguns put in my face, but I'm telling you this, it's natural. Fight or flight is natural for a human being. But for me, it's a matter of, okay, if it's that time, it's that time. Let's have it. Let's have it. If you want to do this or you're not, you know, there's no sense in having some long, drawn-out conversation like you see on TV. Let's have it, or let me walk away, because that's what I'm going to do. But that's my perspective. But there's others who don't share the same perspective. When you're talking about healing, you have to have a foundation, right? Because if you don't, you're going to find that everything is going to stay just the way it was. There will be no change. It's just going to keep right on, right? right on going, and you'll be finding yourself in that same cycle. And somewhere along the line, you know, you have to change the cycle. You have to stop the cycle.
I made a lot of changes throughout the years of my life, many changes that were necessary for me to continue to grow as a person. Raised in South Philadelphia Project in Wilson Park from 1965 till 1978, my family did their best to keep me from falling prey to the streets. And even